Experience in the Balkans and in Serbia, you know, the civil society played a huge constructive role in overcoming the Milosevic regime, but still always the emotions are on the rise. There is a, let's say, legitimate grievance and legitimate emotions because of the war and conflict. So how it happened and what effort it had taken kind of come back to the more moderate mode after the conflict. Yeah. That's very relevant for Ukraine, I think.
Yeah. Well, first of all, it must be said that overcoming the Milosevic regime took a combined effort of oppositional politicians, of civil society, and I would say of progressive media, who were the voice of those progressive tendencies. The fact that we then came into a mode of democracy, and every beginning is difficult. We called all these societies young democracies, where institutions began to be consolidated, where the habits of using the rule of law and rights and Freedom of Information Acts, there had to be a learning process, and that took time for the voice of the people to really be heard, but it also required politicians to be sensitive to what people needed. And again, like in what we're seeing in Western societies, in these societies, politicians realized that it was not enough just to be elected and then to rule for 4 years and not to listen to the people. There's more sensitivity, and civil society has learned to push and pressure more than they did. It is not always easy because of the general socioeconomic situation where people are not living so well. But then we also have the remains or the strong emotions of nationalist groups, of civil society that we do not always agree with. And those are the people who believe that maybe this European direction is not the right one. They sometimes turn towards Russia. And look at return of more social conservative ideas and do not appreciate some of these more progressive. So, in short, it's a daily struggle. Democracy is a daily issue. Democracy is a very fragile plant, and we need to nurture that plant every day, and not to just because we have elections that are free, that it's taken for granted.
And also, I would ask you, as somebody with this life, when you've been to the opposition of the, authoritarian regime in Serbia, and later you joined the government and you've been advising the democratic prime minister Zoran Djindjic, but also, and we have some kind of people with that kind of story in Ukraine and in this part of the world. But later, why this kind of the former opposition leaders are coming to the government? What are the things you would warn? What are mistakes you think you've done to some extent? Because, and also, how would you assess to what extent there was a backslash than, some of the revenge in Serbia when the democratic ideas have become not popular and other parties had won? So what do you think you've done differently, and what would be your warning?
Well, first of all, I think it's important that there is this movement of people from civil society to politics, and in our society back from politics to civil society or other walks of life. We are societies that have come out of a very long period of communism, which means an authoritarian society where politics was the monopoly of one ideology, and where people were atomized. The Communist Party kept people not working with each other. So to learn to have the freedom of assembly, to have the freedom of speech, to have rights takes time. And that is what we all worked in these societies. I think the warning is that when you come into politics, you then really realize how difficult it is to be juggling 20 balls at one time, and some balls will fall to the floor, and you will not be able to implement all the valid ideas that one had when while was in civil society, seeing the difficulties. So realism, I think, is an important thing, which doesn't mean to abandon neither the values nor the ideals that we have, but realize that it takes time. And that is always difficult when people are not living well, that times for reform are difficult and that they require perseverance and commitment without faltering.
Would you give some examples maybe in the Balkans as well? Because you work both through the Western institution and the think tanks, but as well, you probably know the region and also talk to a lot of these kind of things, which happening, all, I think, all over. It is a bit, I guess it's a relevant experience.
Yes,
to the
indeed. We all, meaning both societies and governments whom we have elected, have committed themselves and want to join the European Union in this case. But what does that mean? That simply means we want to become good, better, more just, and more democratic societies. And then the membership in the Union is simply a confirmation that we have become countries where the rule of law and justice prevails. There's no other work than getting up every day and continuing to pressure governments to change in the direction of having more democracy, of having greater media freedom, of having more independent judiciary, more independent prosecution. There's no way around, there's no magic wand which will change this. There's no voice from Brussels or Washington or forever or wherever it comes from that can change this. We do need the help. We don't, in my society, which is much smaller than yours, there's no real economic wealth. So we need investments. We need people who do development aid from European Union in particular to come and help build that substructure on which we would have a democracy. So this cannot be done alone, even though I say most of the work is on our part. We need a little help from our friends, as the word goes, to be able to move forward. And it's only in that perseverance, in that insistence to make our elected officials do what they promised us in elections that this will happen. It's not enough to vote a government that we believe will change and then go home and do our thing. It needs to be an insistent and persistent activity.
You don't want to deploy a peacekeeping mission of any sort until there is an agreement between the parties to the conflict, and at the very minimum is an agreement for a ceasefire that is credible and believable. Once you've reached that degree of agreement, and ideally a deeper, better agreement, then you can deploy a peacekeeping force. The size of your peacekeeping force is in direct proportion to the depth and comprehensiveness of the agreement. The agreement would cover such things as borders. I have always found it helpful in considering how to handle some of these difficult issues to differentiate between the conflict, the actual fighting, and those people who are doing the actual fighting, and the confrontation, the political issue that has led to the fighting. If you can disentangle that, then you can possibly start to find a route to a resolution. The people doing the fighting, you have to deal with them at some point, otherwise why would they stop? And again, I think you have to remind yourself that you make peace with your enemies, not your friends.
what to do with an incredible amount of arms, and how do you do a disarmament? How do you work with the people who used to, you know, carry a weapon after you reach the agreement?
I'm sorry we keep harping on about the need for an agreement, but in the experience of other parts of the world, that's the essential starting point. The agreement itself needs to deal with the question of the disposal of arms. And in Northern Ireland, the conflict I have most direct experience of, it was left on the basis that all the parties to the agreement would apply their best endeavours to enabling the decommissioning of weapons within 2 years. But that was not an understanding that bound the terrorist groups themselves, and it therefore took much longer. And eventually, over a longer period, the best part of 10 years, there was a negotiation that led to the arms of the IRA being put beyond use and the IRA ceasing to operate. In Colombia, it's happened much more quickly because the actual agreement envisaged the FARC handing over their weapons in special centres to the United Nations in a way that the United Nations could vouch for.
Your expertise is so much about the, you know, change of the constitution and especially in the case of conflict. But really to what you answer on the fact that maybe the constitution is something which is stable, which keeps the country together, and the fact that it's not always sacred, but that is often the answer we hear from the Ukrainian politicians who said, like, we can't adjust our the main law to the to that issues like the resolution of the conflict, because that could be something else, not the change in the constitution.
I appreciate that in constitutional politics can be very difficult. It's very symbolic, and one of the most difficult things to deal with in conflicts are the symbols. Symbols can become particularly difficult, and some constitutions are often viewed as highly symbolic. What I worry about in Ukraine, and you mentioned the issue of frozen conflict, is that it's difficult to make the necessary compromises, politically difficult. Politicians are always looking over their shoulder at what the public thinks. You've got politicians here, you have politicians in Russia. They both want to be able to declare a victory in terms of the resolution of this. But it's not serving either Russia or Ukraine to have this carry on indefinitely. So it's going to require courage by politicians and understanding by the public that there are going to have to be some difficult changes if the issue is to be resolved.
The biggest risk at the moment is that people will grab at the idea of a peacekeeping force as a solution, as an alternative to actually addressing the issues that are the underlying problem. And I have a very high regard for the military. But military people do what they do. They don't solve political conflicts. And at some point, there needs to be the kind of effective and consistent political engagement that will reach that kind of solution. The risk is that a peacekeeping operation will be seen as an easy way of deflecting the immediate issue and will lead to a frozen conflict.
Mr. Jeffrey, you've served as a political director in the Northern Ireland office during the most, I think, like, very interesting time, 1998-2002, and you were also dealing with the establishing the police force, you know, maintaining the security. So what are the challenges? Of course, in Ukraine today, it looks like something way ahead, but really, what are the most important practicalities on how you establish not just the security in the region, and who could serve there? What do you do with the people who were there with arms, besides disarmament?
The position here is different, I think, because I'm not sure that the nature of policing is quite as much at the centre of the conflict as it was in Northern Ireland. But there's also the advantage, which I think it must be to some extent, that the government here has already been thinking for some years about reforming the police service in the rest of Ukraine and has made some progress on that. So you're not starting here with a blank sheet of paper by any means.
How do you recruit the people, and what do you do with the people who served and fought on the other side? And that is a big concern of, I think, here.
We know that is a very sensitive issue here. in Northern Ireland, the, first of all, because of the intercommunal dimension of it, it was important that the new service should recruit equally from the two communities. And by doing so, over the last 10 years, it has changed the composition of the force quite significantly. Like any other police force, it will not recruit people with blood on their hands, serious criminal convictions. But it doesn't discriminate on the basis of political views. And it has succeeded to a very significant effect in recruiting from across the whole community. In the case that we face here, I'm not sure. I mean, clearly there will be reservations, strong reservations, about the serving in a new police service, those who were involved in the occupied territories as they now stand.
You have to distinguish between those who have sort of been genuine criminals in a serious sense, yeah, exactly, and avoiding looking punitive in a very broad sense. I mean, the whole politics of reaching an accommodation should be to make the people in the occupied territories feel that they're going to be welcomed back into Ukraine as Ukrainian citizens and respected as Ukrainian citizens, and that there isn't going to be some sort of massive purge or what have you. It has to be a nation-building exercise and building human and personal links again between the two communities. If it's too punitive, then there'll be a tremendous resistance towards a settlement. Longer term, the costs to Ukraine of the issue in Donbass are tremendous, and it's not satisfactory longer term to have the kind of relationship you have now with Russia.
Well, we have a couple of questions which the audience sent to us, and I'd like to address them, Mr. Smith, that is considered that non-controlled territories are under complete economic and social blockade, but we have the fully, you know, the Russian economy is operating, the Russian currency and the social payments. How all these factors also influence on these issues like the establishing the peacekeeping mission?
The military deployed have very little to do with answering those issues. That's not what the military do. They may produce the stable situation in which other agencies can deal with those situation.
One of the issues which inevitably come up in these types of conversations is the issue of how you engage. It's Russia's at the table, Ukraine's at the table, but there is this very difficult issue of do you engage with the people who present themselves as the leaders of the governments in the occupied territories? If so, what do you engage with them on? What are the issues that you have to discuss with them, and what issues can you not discuss with them? This is a really tricky problem, and in any negotiation, finding the right interlocutors for the key issues is central, and there's no easy answer here, but I think there's going to have to be some sort of engagement with those people, but they're not legitimate for certain purposes. And then you get into the question of, well, when do elections happen, after elections, what kinds of issues might be dealt with then, and can those issues be left till after elections? The issue of policing is one where policing hasn't been devolved, but there are some really interesting things that have been done in terms of community relations under the new structure of policing, including the accountability relations between chiefs of police in the regions and communities. You run through the list, and sometimes you find that things are not quite as difficult as you thought they were once you get beyond the symbols and into the nitty-gritty. How much is the conflict costing? Is it costing in terms of your military expenditures, but also the fact that you don't have normal relationships with your very large country to the east? I mean, all of the issues around gas transportation and so on. I mean, it's a mess. It's not for me to put a number on it, but there are big costs to the current status quo. Are they bigger than the cost of a settlement? And my view would be a settlement properly designed needn't be that expensive. I mean, obviously there'll be some costs of reconstruction, But if the bigger you can get a political agreement, the less you need expensive military or peacekeeping arrangements around that, and you can start moving forward with reconstruction. I mean, one of the advantages you have in Ukraine is that the population we're talking about in the occupied areas or the particular districts is relatively small. So I don't think that whatever settlement emerges there, whether it's constitutional or otherwise, is likely to sort of upset the basic functioning of government in Ukraine. And over time, I suspect that whatever it is, you'll be able to adapt to.
Anytime we come to the, not this kind of discussion, but the discussion about any kind of practicalities or something, that would be always the command that, you know, maybe we could discuss even with the separatists, with those people, but because then we're looking what are the interests of each group, how would everybody benefit. In the end, it's up to them to live together. But then the whole issue of Russia comes up, that, you know, that there is a totally different motivation of Russia rather than anybody who is thinking about amnesty or would stay in Donetsk anyway. So how you really do what you're doing that?
I think that is why we three have been more than reluctant even than we would normally be to express opinions about the situation here now, because we understand that a large dimension of it is the relationship with the Russian Federation. My own sense is that it won't be resolved until there is a clearer understanding between the two countries involved. But I would suggest that if that can be achieved, there will then still need to be the kind of internal process of political settlement in these parts of the country that we, for our part, for example, have faced in the United Kingdom. We know that Russia is the elephant in this room in that sense, and that's where a really effective negotiation needs to take place, but there are other issues entailed in this problem as well, which will need to be thought about sometime.
My first question is about the Donbass law. The lawmakers had voted in its favour. The bill is now on the president's desk to be signed. Our question is, you are the main ideologist behind this bill, so how is it going to be implemented? Can you tell us a bit more?
First off, Russia is now officially recognized as an aggressor country, and this wrecks Putin's plans to mask his aggressive military operation under a peacekeeping one. Secondly, the law clearly determines the technique for protecting those Ukrainian citizens who were forced to stay on the occupied territories and those who had to leave their homes and are in Ukraine now. They lost their property, estates, and so on. The law clearly states that any actions that are carried out in the occupied Donbas will not be legally recognized. While it holds diplomatic methods as the top priority, the law also provides the opportunity for Ukraine to use force, armed forces, and other power institutions to their full potential in order to defend the country, fight back against aggression, and restore the country's sovereignty in the occupied territories.
Do we understand correctly that the philosophy of the Donbas law allows the use of force in order to restore the occupied territories?
We're not saying that the only way to do it is by force, by the use of the armed forces, but this law does not rule out this method and creates the right conditions for that, so that no additional legislative acts are required to be taken and there is a legal foundation for the use of force and resisting the aggressor already. At the same time, the law also does not rule out the diplomatic method, quite the opposite. No one canceled the Minsk agreements. Yes, Russia is trying to sabotage them, Russia is trying to neutralize them, but at the same time, the president deems the diplomatic method as one of his most preferred ones today.
You spoke of the people who stayed in the occupied territories, that the law provides them with legal status and the territories are seen as temporarily occupied. How would you, as the Secretary of the National Security and Defense Council, refer to the people who stayed at the temporary occupied territories?
Many people were just forced to stay, and of course, among them, there are those who cooperate with the occupant administrations. Because the LPR and the DPR are fake titles to cover up for the military occupant administrations installed by Russia on the occupied territory. And of course, there are those who cooperate, and even more, those who took part in riots against their own country, took part in military or criminal activities. There are many of those, but there are also those who don't have any other option, who stay in their houses and have to work in some establishments.
Last year, a whole array of measures to resist Russia's hybrid war actions came into force. We remember there was a ban on Russian social media and a change in the rules for crossing the border, as well as an expansion of the economic sanctions and many other things. Were there any results of these measures? How can one sense a result under hybrid war conditions?
Friends, if those results didn't exist, we wouldn't have an independent European Ukraine. So the fact that it exists is a proof of our joint victory, and it's a proof that Putin can't meet the goals he set and wanted to meet in the beginning of 2014. There is no such thing as a free, independent, and European Ukraine in Russia's format of imperial revanche.
But do you not think that these methods resemble the methods of Putin's Russia?
Which ones?
When we speak of certain restrictions, bans, isn't it like fighting Russia using their own methods? You probably saw how serious the discussions were in the society when you banned social media websites like ВКонтакте, Одноклассники, and other websites.
When there is a hybrid war and no methods to resist it, the country becomes unprotected. And I, as NSDC secretary, who initiated many sanctions, restrictions, including the ban on Russian social media and other information resources used not only as information tools, but also as an aggressive cyber tool against our country, I think that it's our duty. How did Russia play the game? It turned the freedoms of both European and non-European countries, like the United States and others, into their weaknesses. When the West pushed for the importance of not putting any restrictions on the media and the information they provide, it turned some media into a weapon. We can see it with Crimea. First there is Russian media, and then there are Russian tanks.
Mr. Turchinov, since you raised this topic, do you agree that freedom can be restricted for the sake of security under the condition of a hybrid war?
The line is based on our constitution. There is a law that allows limiting some serious things if there is incoming military aggression.
How long will we need to restore the control over the occupied territories without considering the Russian factor? How long do we need to wait? We've developed our army, we see some progress. So how long?
A lot depends on our strategic partners. Unfortunately, there are many new politicians coming into European governments who say that it's Ukraine's problem without realizing that Ukraine is Europe's outpost and that the Ukrainians don't just defend Ukrainian independence, but Europe too. We stopped the progress of Russia's aggression toward the West, so it's quite an irresponsible attitude from them. We really needed their help back then, and I didn't receive a single cartridge.
But why is this happening? Do global leaders even think of Ukraine as a subject, or are we still just an object in their eyes?
Unfortunately, it's a problem. Ukraine is treated as a problem. Like, you see, we lose our own profits because of Ukraine, because of the sanctions. Have you noticed how often the question of canceling Russian sanctions is raised now in various European countries? You see, they don't sense this. Their matters are more important to them than someone else's. There is no understanding that it's not just about Ukraine as a European state, but about a civilizational choice and the future of Europe. And what's our problem? We don't learn from history. History teaches us that it doesn't teach us anything. Unfortunately, that's how it is. For example, there were the Munich agreements when Hitler received part of Czechia to calm him down. They didn't want to irritate the aggressor. And then they spilled their blood all over European land. So I find this formula, don't irritate the aggressor, deceptive and dangerous. Russia makes claims to its imperial rights, to its rights to other countries' territories. They even do it demonstratively now. And this doesn't just concern Ukraine.
Do I understand correctly that you're not planning to take part in any form in the 2019 presidential elections?
I worked as president and I didn't like it. No sleep, tremendous workload. Therefore, I am not planning to run for president or to head any political party.
Describe your relationship with the president, taking into account the history of your difficult political relations, coming back to the year of 2005. How did you manage to reconcile and in what state is your relationship right now?
One needs to make conclusions from feuds and from their own political experience. I made my own, and I think so did Poroshenko. I am in charge of defense matters, so I view the president as the supreme commander. That's how I see him when I follow his commands and orders.
So, not partners, friends, or allies?
I don't throw out labels such as friend. It's not in my nature. But I do think that we work in the same direction and solve the same problems, which concern security and defense. The supreme commander gives out orders and I obey them. That's a normal relationship. And, of course, I think that there are mistakes made. There are problems. But our relationship allows me to make a point when I agree or disagree with a certain decision. But once this decision is approved and the decree is signed, we have to obey. But I want to say that the president often takes my advice into account. At the same time, his experience is crucial for making the right decisions.
I looked into business from Donbass and Luhansk state and they left. So what I can say that from the very beginning, like in the first chaotic months of the crisis, of the military escalation, business was trying to figure out what was going on. The business was not an active political actor on neither side, I would say. So business people who had something to lose, you know, assets and clients and money and capital and finances, especially after the bank transactions became impossible, they left. So I would say that medium and slightly upper medium business group, they left to the government-controlled territories or to Russia, much less to Russia, I would say. Those who had their equipment, their factories, their workshops, their buildings, real estate, they were caught in a truly difficult situation because this was all that they had, so to speak, and they could not transport, they could not disassemble their equipment and take it to a safer place, so to speak. So in the end, some decided to abandon all their business. Some decided to re-register it with someone who stayed there. Some other businesses left their businesses to their parents, to their relatives, etc., to wait and see. For the majority of business companies, small and medium, that I interviewed on the side of non-government controlled territories, they stayed simply because they couldn't leave, right? Because stories of IDP entrepreneurs were not all that rosy and successful either. Very few stayed because of ideological convictions. Overall, business in Donbass, people whom I spoke to, are rather apolitical. What they care about is transparency, is clear rules, possibility to do business, to keep connections, etc. All were very much upset about the blockade. And I refer to the blockade introduced early on in the conflict and not the recent official blockade. Ban on commercial transactions and on taking cargo across the line of contact, except the list of the enterprises whose raw materials were of key importance for strategic industry in Ukraine.
And you also write that there are some moral and ethical dilemmas for the people who are willing to do business, especially those based in the occupied territories of the Donbas. What are these dilemmas and to what extent they are influencing?
I spoke to individuals, quite many, and their stories were quite typical. By and large, in Donetsk, they do not have loyalty to the local authorities or de facto authorities, so to speak. They do have loyalty to their place. So they felt they could not abandon it because, you know, if they leave, what will happen to what would happen to Donetsk? In Luhansk, this local patriotism, so to speak, is as strong. However, in Luhansk, what we can see today, they're drifting further and further away from Kyiv, much further than Donetsk, and they somehow grew to believe in the future of their republic. At least they refer to our young republic, we will do whatever. In terms of the affinity to Kyiv, it's a problem for all. Because, you know, they felt that they were abandoned. I mean, it's a very common narrative that they waited that somehow this conflict will be resolved very soon, very quickly, you know. But then they saw that Kyiv was not, in their opinion, was not very much motivated to resolve it quickly. And instead, it's a long-lasting war, now low intensity, but who knows whether it can escalate. So these people found themselves between, like, a rock in a hard place, so to speak.
And what is their willingness to go on cooperation with the rest of Ukraine? And to what extent the Ukrainian goods and everything is substituted? By what is substituted? What kind of job those people have?
Well, in early months and a couple of years right after 2014, irrespective of the ban, thanks to ubiquitous corruption, goods were going back and forth, right? And Ukrainian goods were common in supermarkets and in other places in the NGC, non-government controlled areas. However, it was becoming more and more increasingly risky business because crossing a line of contact was never risk-free, so to speak. And although people sort of knew about the so-called tariffs that they had to pay at checkpoints, on both sides, by the way, the rules may have changed, right? So this created a sense of insecurity. So that's why what my first study showed in 2015, entrepreneurs in Luhansk, Donetsk, very reluctantly, but quite quickly, reorientated towards Russian supplies. They would all say that the minute the situation normalizes and things become as they used to be, they would immediately restore business relations with Ukrainian partners because they still preferred Ukrainian goods and Ukrainian services to Russian ones, of course. Now, what happened in 2016? In Donetsk, people are businesses are still quite happy to trade with the rest of Ukraine or Ukrainian partners, Ukrainian companies. In Luhansk, the process seems to go, I wouldn't say irreversible, but quite far from the departure point. And the narrative became that we cannot trust the quality of Ukrainian products. We cannot trust Ukrainian partners, etc. So we prefer Russian supplies. So that's, this is what blockade and isolation normally does to human relations. Because business is an important, not only economically, but also in terms of people's interaction, right? And combating myths and stereotypes.
How about the big business? And also, we knew that Donbas is a heavily industrialized place. So it can be compared to South Ossetia or Transnistria or any other, this kind of frozen conflict republic in post-Soviet space. Because those are the smaller territories, somewhere there are more, let's say, agricultural places. That was a heavy industry. It requires really, this region lives from the big contracts, import, export. It's not that a couple of people can do that. And it requires some of the legality. To what extent, the whole shape of the way the region is financed had changed? And also, what is the role of the oligarchs? What's happening with their business, of those who actually own the region?
Right question. Well, Donbas, Donetsk and Luhansk, they were net exporters as opposed to other regions of Ukraine. So they were the major exporters of coal, of steel, and other stuff, and the source of hard currency that was coming into Ukraine, by the way. In order to export, one needs legality, right? One needs a certificate of origin, etc. Therefore, for enterprises to continue their export, they had to retain their Ukrainian registration. That was not easy, as you can understand. And some just preferred just to close their enterprises. Some others opened, companies in Russia. There are a few, but still, there were companies like that, companies in Russia, and were exporting through the new Russian companies. But the majority of big mines and metal, steel production under Rinat Akhmetov, for instance, they retained they changed their registration from Donetsk to Kramatorsk, for example, in the government-controlled territories, and continued export in a legal way. Again, because there was an exception, they were exempt from the ban on commercial cargo activities, right? So they were allowed to take their coal out and to take steel in, or the other way around, right? So this interesting scheme was functioning up till March 2017, when first it was a spontaneous blockade by some individuals and battalions, and then it was nationalization, so to speak, or external management introduced to these big companies, and then there was an official decree of the president, right, about the official blockade. So now these assets are lost, it's not very clear whether they operate. Some of them do, but clearly the volume of production is much less. simply because even keeping afloat these huge enterprises requires a lot of money. There were attempts on behalf of the de factos to come and make some, you know, mines and factories to pay taxes in the so-called republics, which they refused to do because they need clean reputation in order to be exporters, right? Besides, they had all these huge staff, miners and workers who were paid on their Ukrainian accounts, right? So so now it's very unclear what's going on in terms of the of how operational are the mines and enterprises. Some mines are flooded, so it's a very sad story. What I know from what I heard that coal goes via Russian ports to Turkey and to other places, or even returns to Ukraine as a Russian coal via an official Ukrainian Russian port.
I can see that Ukraine has made great steps in changing its society. Well, it is attempting to do steps to change its economic climate for the better so that it will be an even playground for all businesses. I could see that particularly in the east of the country, politicians are thinking how to support SME development. So all this part looks quite hopeful. On the other hand, we know that there has been some stalemate in creation of the anti-corruption court, and there is a problem of internally displaced people, etc. So you have quite a high number of challenges, and the highest among these challenges, obviously, is the low-intensity war, which is going on in eastern Ukraine.
You are well known for your active work with the civil society, with the representatives of the civil sector. What you can advise for Ukrainian authorities how to go through this barrier between the society and government?
You just must accept that civil society and voluntary action normally is directed at the points which hurt the society most, and which definitely need quick attention from politicians. And if you accept that, then you realize that cooperation with non-governmental organizations and voluntary groups takes your state forward really quickly. In Estonia, we use this as a model of 21st century public management, that we actively seek to create services which are supported both by the government, local government, and NGOs. And we have noticed that over the years, NGOs have amassed a huge amount of information and methods, for example, to forward social policies in the country. They are really good think tanks. So supporting them seems simply more reasonable to develop your societies. And it's also guaranteeing you that you are working with issues which matter, because I've not yet seen a voluntary action which deals with matters which are not important for society. And your activity list renews itself constantly, because if civil society loses interest, probably the problem has been solved, gone away, and you can move onwards, which is very different to the traditional public sector services creation, where you for 5 years, think what to provide and then provide a uniform service to everybody. This is too costly and too slow for people to get what they really need. And that's why we operate with NGOs. They pinpoint the painful points in the society.
And how can you evaluate this work in Ukraine? I know you have met with some representatives of public sector. What did they say? What do you think?
I have to say that they were very optimistic about particular reforms, healthcare, decentralization. And they see, of course, where you should go further. Like, they were very worried about the inactivity about declarations of economic interest, for example. They were very worried about the creation of the anti-corruption court. So they pinpoint exactly on the issues in the society which are painful. They apply pressure there, and a clever politician, of course, works with them and hears this signal. And I could also see that they have clearly been heard in this society. They were not at all hopeless. They were quite hopeful, I have to say, about Ukrainian development.
Another thing, unfortunately, sometimes Ukrainian-Estonian relationships are remembered in the context of the investment scandals, for example, in Kyiv's Sky Mall and in Odessa's Zatoka, where, as many say, local mafia just tried to seize the money from the investor. Have you raised this issue with the talks with the Poroshenko? And what can you say? Will Estonia continue to invest in Ukraine after all?
First of all, Estonia does not invest in Ukraine. It's Estonian businesses who decide where to invest. And of course, I would be very astonished if somebody right now started a big real estate investment project from Estonia. So these old issues need to be sorted out. And I'm quite optimistic that as Ukraine develops as rule of law, these cases will be sorted out. Definitely, they are very visible in Estonia. And I've heard that also companies from other countries are facing similar difficulties. So indeed, you need to develop your economic climate in general and your rule of law state in general. But people will look at the particularities and concrete cases. If they are solved, I'm quite sure that this will unleash a new wave of interest in Ukraine. Meanwhile, I'm afraid that our companies are still very interested, but I see that most of this interest is in trade, where the loss of heavy investment risk is much lower.
You were an economics advisor to the Prime Minister in the time when Estonia started to introduce the electronic governance system. Ukraine is trying to do so, and after the meeting, President Poroshenko said that Ukraine and Estonia will do this thing in Ukraine. So what were the hardships? What Ukraine should do to make this efficient?
First of all, you cannot compare development of digital state to another state because every state is a culture anyway, and your state culture will prevail also in your digital state. So everybody must find their own ways. Also, you cannot compare digital of the beginning of the century to the digital of today. The risks are different, the opportunities and possibilities nowadays are much better. So you shouldn't be looking what we have been doing, but you should be looking what are our objectives of service provision and use the most modern technology you can afford to use. It doesn't probably need to be very cutting edge, but it definitely wouldn't be exactly the same as we did because time has gone by. And what you need is just the will. And I can see here is clearly...
Чисто виходять двоє. Пішли. Входимо.
Тепер відход. Дим пішов.
Видихай, бобер, ти що старичок змучився, бачиш.
Я ще фори дам.
Зараз ще один розійдеться і ще раз розпитимося.
How old are you?
24.
What made you join the armed forces?
I don't know. My whole family had served. So my granddad, dad, and I decided to serve. I went to the volunteer service in Lviv, to the 80th Air Assault Brigade. There were different kinds of training, trips to the training ground, and then a trip to where the government's military operations take place in the east. My most memorable moments from then were in Slavyansk and from the Luhansk airport.
Move only if you hear a shot somewhere behind you. Shout contact, and it's advised to say contact at 11, at 12, so that the friends you're working with, who are in the rooms, so that they can hear and understand that you've made contact and then you're not shooting. You understand?
This is a formal training at the Yarovsky Training Center. Maybe for a month or two after this they'll have a break and then they'll go to the east maybe.
Like he's tied up and then you take him away, push his head down so that he can't see anything.
Better still, if you have a sack, put the sack over his head. I'm not joking.
No, I get it. Here's one. There are cartridges inside. Look, here's another one.
Four magazines, right?
I have three magazines. I have three, so one, two, three. Yes.
Without any approach, without anything at all, just go.
I get it.
Руки за гол. Став! На стенку руки! Тримаєш? Стоять. Чистый. Руку, голову.
Выводим.
До стены. На колени. Все.
Everything that we do here would be a matter of life and death in a real battle. My partner's life, for example, if I don't cover my sector properly, my life will depend on it. And everything we are taught here gives us an understanding of what it's like. Even though they have fought in different wars, weapons are the same everywhere. Bullets are the same everywhere. Missiles, that's all.
Забороняю стріляти несправною зброєю і несправними боєприпасами. Готові? Заряджай.
Overall, the instructors here are professionals, and if they carried out a training like they did in the Soviet Union or somewhere else, just to have a soldier come in, shoot 12 rounds and leave, everyone here has served, so everyone knows how to do it. This right here is completely different. Of course, we have the anti-terrorist operation going on in this country, even if they call it something different now. That's why there's more preparation, more spent per soldier, there's more attention on the individual soldier. If we're talking about the units we teach, those are first of all staff trainings. So preparing the staff based at the headquarters of the 2nd Battalion of the 80th Brigade. Polish instructors are also working in areas such as artillery, fire support, intelligence groups, and riflemen, as well as sapper groups. We make ignition tubes, we explode small pellets so that we can see what we are dealing with, what kind of personnel we are dealing with. We also check the building for tripwires, mines and other kinds of surprises, which we know from experience were used in the anti-terrorist operation zone. Personnel have to make mistakes, and we have to tell them that so that they make those mistakes here and not in the anti-terrorist operation zone.
We are now heading to the headquarters, and as instructors, we will give lessons there. They carry out tactical staff training programs. We will mostly observe their work, but along the way, we will show them how to improve based on our own experiences. During these staff trainings, information is exchanged as to certain operations. New orders are received every minute, which, after discussion, are delegated to the servicemen.
Заданих точках, готових до переходу в атаку на зачистку об'єкта майорів. Прийом.
Мінометку поставте на свої міста, розвідку спросіть, де він
знаходиться. We observe the work in the tactical operational center. We carry out combat missions. The subunits defend us and stop the opposition from breaking through.
Artillery is the real god of war, and artillery weapons are the most powerful in my opinion, because you can have the missile, the gun, and shoot 15 kilometers in distance. You can't even see the enemy, but you shoot.
From the time that we got here last November to now, there's been tremendous improvements in several areas. The development of quality standards has come along, particularly for the heavy weapon systems. We're getting close to finished product. The use of mission orders and planning, and particularly like the development of concept of operation sketches, has come from being a rough idea to being pretty proficient.
Різні моменти були
There have been various incidents. We've been covered with missiles and mortars and large caliber weapons. Tanks fired at us. I was injured right at the very end. I was the last day. It was the last day just before we left. The artillery unit started to severely shoot at us. We ran for cover, and 5 minutes after, there was a real big explosion. And that was it. I don't remember anything else. I just switched off. When I came out of it, everything was smoky. Everything. And there were those concrete slabs on my feet. They were pressing on my feet. They didn't land all the way up my leg. They were just pressing down really hard on my feet. Our guys ran while under fire. They dug themselves in. One guy died. He was crushed by the slabs. Others got concussions, different kinds of injuries like that.
Starting from the limbs, we check for bleeding. We check with our hands to see if he has a head injury or bullet holes. Then we take off his bulletproof vest. Then we cut all his clothes with scissors. Check the ribs aren't broken, turn him onto his side, in the recovery position. Now he's ready to be evacuated. Have you covered medicine at this point?
Yes, we have.
Are you seeing something different, or is everything pretty much the same?
Different, and everything is mixed up.
Completely different. Now, split into pairs and do exactly what he did. Choose who's going to be injured and then swap places.
You go somewhere and look at the students who are studying, going out, sitting in bars or somewhere. But people are already used to watching the news. People can get used to anything. They can reconcile themselves to some things and not to others. And after 24 years, my opinion on war has changed. You can't sleep as well as you used to. You can break down in the middle of the night. It doesn't happen that often, after someone reminds me of something during a conversation with friends. But I've become tougher, maybe.
That's everything. Now switch.
Don't take off your vest.
Why?
Because of the microphone. Just pretend that you're taking it off.
And when you're checking up on your injured friend and see an injury, use the first aid kit, which can be found at...
I am Ivan Ostapovich, director of the Lviv Organ Hall.
My name is Taras Demko. I am the deputy director of the Organ Hall.
I'm Marta Ivanishin. I hold the position of director here at Alexander Dubchenko Cultural Education Center.
My name is Olya Hanchar. I'm the director of the Memorial Museum of Totalitarian Regimes, Territory of Terror.
Officially, the Lviv House of Organ and Chamber Music was set up in 1988, when I was born, so I am actually the same age as the Organ Hall. We can build a team, we can use some sort of community building with our male and female listeners, and I think that is really important. This place has enormous potential. This is one of the most unknown places in Lviv. It's one of the biggest concert halls. We don't really let anyone else up here because this is where the organ is. It's easily damaged.
When we first started working here, there was a lot of trash. There was trash on the stage. There were these decorative flowers, which they considered beautiful.
There was a lot of these flowers on the stage.
Flowers like this. We've had a few complaints that this is disrespectful to Taras Shevchenko. A lot of people want Shevchenko back on the organ.
I've worked here since November. This is my fourth month. We had to do the paperwork as well as the repair work and approving the repertoire. We do all this together with the team. We work on everything, let's say. Okay, in April then. We'll do it in April. Good, thank you. We need to sort the bills out. You hear?
I'll do it now. I don't really want to climb up there.
You don't want to?
No.
Well, let's go. You've already brought me here, so let's climb.
Ah, there is no light here.
There is no light? So shall we climb up here or not? Do you want to? Yes, I'll try.
I don't want to go up there. Okay, let's go.
I get so afraid every time I climb up here.
There is 5,000 pipes there.
5,000?
Big ones like that one. Small ones, wooden ones, different types of metal ones. We still have some older employees who try and call us by our patronymics. Some people are just used to doing that. So I'm Taras Volodymyrovich. I personally don't like patronymics. I think that in our language, this is slightly rudimentary. It's post-imperial. But that's my personal opinion. If someone wants to call me by my patronymics, let them. That's okay. But nevertheless, we want to create a limitless atmosphere. Our toilets are really interesting. There was once a baptistry here, when it was a Catholic church. They christened children here. Now it's a toilet. That's a real shame. According to old photographs and general drawings of the building, it's evident that there were paintings here by the famous Polish artist Jan Rosen. Based on our suspicions that there were frescoes here, we commissioned professional restorers and they took soundings. Soundings are small openings in the surface of the fresco. You can see the face of a saint, and here you can see various inscriptions. The plan is to restore the frescoes and move the toilets from here. This process is actually already started, and we have a specific budget for it. It's difficult to acknowledge, but living in our country is a choice. I choose to live in our country and change it. I feel that I'm needed here, and that what I do not only for myself, but for others. And for the time being, this is enough of a stimulus and motivation for me.
As long as I have a stockpile of ideas, as long as I have an idea of what this place lacks, I see that it doesn't have. It means I have a responsibility.
In life, I've always done what I've wanted to do, what I want to do. Our story started with demolishing the toilets. We demolished absolutely everything and made new repairs. Mr. Mikhailo, look, this soap thing is already broken. Our goal is to carry out this reform in the cultural sector. I don't know how to do that, but I also don't understand why it can't be done. There is no problem that can't be solved. We just need to simply believe in that and every day take on and carry out this really difficult work. We won't refuse the previous tenant stuff. However, conceptually, we already have other visions for what should be done in this hall. Actually, we will be working on these things. Like, what's in this hall? Instead of popcorn, chocolate and nuts, we would be better off using this space for people to come, read maybe, and do other things. This structure that we are in now, even the building, needs completely transforming. It needs transforming in the direction of culture, cinema, conferences, creativity. We need to create this creative spot for cultural industry. Big creative things, creative development. You see what you are building here, and you see your results. It's so nice and incredible when you do something and get results straight away.
I didn't recognize you.
Do you recognize me yet?
You're the manager?
We waved to you on the camera.
I see. I looked for the keys straight away. We need to open the museum.
Yes, definitely.
And the toilets need to be opened.
We are at the Memorial Museum of Totalitarian Regimes, Territory of Terror. The museum complex tells the history of Transit Prison No. 25. We're not open today.
Oh, you're closed. And what do you have here?
At the moment, we have an exhibition on Amina Okuyeva, and we host different projects and events.
And what's that wagon?
We have a freight wagon. The museum tells the story of the transit prison, so Ukraliznitsa gave us this wagon as a symbol.
I thought it was Putin who gave you this nice wagon.
No, Putin has not given us anything.
Okay, thank you.
Let's try.
You're welcome. The theme of terror does not limit us in any way and allows us to work on projects relating to completely differing aspects of human life. Here, part of an exhibition is being planned. You will be able to go into the wagon and listen, have a look at the memoirs that we have gathered from people who were repressed. But not yet. We're still working on it. From the barrack for this exhibition, we want to open the museum to everyone at the end of this year. In the first barrack, we tell the story of how someone lost their home. So our visitors enter this building and find themselves in a cozy Lviv flat. Here, for example, they can listen to music from the time, look at everything, touch with their hands. In this part of the exhibition, we then find ourselves in the flat after a raid has taken place. Here is the boundary. It shows that here we have a parquet floor and here it's wood. There will be a certain number of prisoners here, a prison. So one step away from the cozy flat and you're inside a prison now. A museum can be interesting. Everything depends on the manager. Our audience is specific because the museum is complex, the theme is difficult, and a lot of people who come here come to talk and tell their own stories. Our museum is not the only one in Lviv that has a young manager. It's a sign of great systemic change, and if right now there are efforts to do this in one city, then I'm very interested in being part of these efforts. Systemic changes in culture is the same as in stable institutions. I feel I'm ambitious, that I want to work on one big project and see how it develops.
Yeah.